Again, thank you guys that have been in and out throughout the morning, and now we're into the afternoon. We have just two main talks left. So you're with me for the next 40 to 45 minutes. I'm going to be talking about how genetics, you know, sort of play a role in kidney cancer. We're going to walk through the basics of just genetics itself, give you information about cancer and how genetics relates to cancer. We're going to touch a little bit on testing and then sort of end with the end picture of what this looks like for patients with kidney cancer. So again, don't forget to put your questions in the chat. All right, so let's start with DNA and genes. DNA is a set of chemicals that act as the instructions for our bodies. And so, you know, you've heard DNA a lot, stands for deoxyribonucleic acid. My dog's name is actually Dina because I love genetics. So not only the medical director of KCA, but a genetic counselor by training. And so if we want to think of genes and DNA as a language, DNA is made up of four letters, A, T, C, and G. And you combine those in different sort of patterns to create words or genes. These genes then work together to tell a story, which are the proteins of our bodies, and it make how our bodies look and how they function. And if you think about the collection of all the different stories or all the different genes that we have, that's what the genome is. So when you hear about the genome, it's just the collection of all of our stories. So DNA is sort of been becoming genes. Think of just in comparison, the human genome is about 3.2 billion letters long. We compare that to the longest novel ever written in 1913 that had about 9.6 million letters and spaces throughout the whole novel. The human genome is 300 times or more greater in size than that. So it is a really long bit of information, which we have now fully sequenced. And if you compare people, they're 99.9% the same, which sounds like really, really similar, which does. You know, we're very similar to each other. But that 0.1% is still over 3 million letters that are different. And that's what makes us all unique, from everything to like eye color and hair color to height and all those tiny things there, including the risk for cancer. Each gene can be anywhere from 50 letters to 250 million letters long. And we get one of each from our mom and one of each gene from our dad. So they do come in pairs. However, there was so much genetic information, even though we've sequenced the whole genome and all those letters and we know what that order is, we still don't know the exact thing that all of them do. And the reason I have a picture of a grape here is the Pinot Noir grape has 30,000 genes. Humans have 20 to 25,000. I would like to think we're more complex than the Pinot Noir grape, regardless of you wine enthusiasts out there. But we take those genes and we make over 200,000 different products with those genes. And so a lot of the genes that are there have to multitask and they have to tell us how we're going to, when we have to make a certain product or how much of that product we should make. We call them sort of housekeeping genes. If you want to think of it this way, for every page in a book, there's going to be one sentence that tells you the action and that everything else is just descriptor. And that's sort of what our genome is. So there's a lot of information there, and that's what makes it so complex. There's a lot of different things that are going to affect the story that our DNA and our genes tell. And that could be anything from your diet, could be things about you, like your weight, your gender, other medical conditions that you have, could be things from the environment, could be based on the organ. Or hormones. There's different genes that are going to do different things depending on whether or not we're going through puberty or we're middle-aged or we're going through something like menopause. So the genes not only change based on the person, but the time of any particular person's life and what they're exposed to. And that's why, again, just building on that complexity. So it's not as simple as saying there's one gene that is absolutely going to cause this disorder and everyone's going to have the same symptoms and the same outcome, because everything sort of is a mixture of multifactorial things. So we've used the word mutation here, and mutations in quotes, because it's sort of an old term. We don't really use that anymore. We use more variant instead of mutation, just because we know that there's more variation is what we're talking about. But I'm going to be using mutation most of the time, since that's probably a word you guys are more familiar with. All right, so we've talked a little bit about the basics and how complex and that interplay of words and stories that make up our bodies. So now let's talk a little bit about mutations and sort of how they come about. If you look at this, you know, sort of paragraph here, you can see where I've underlined the word told, T-O-L-L-E-D. It's not the correct version of the word to use there, but spell check is only going to catch that one if you plug it in and you're writing it on your Word document. But there's really, where all these red things are, a lot of other errors. Either it's a correct spelling of a word, but not the right one, like the word review or see. Other times it might be spelled incorrectly. And so our body might need to spell check these errors. The ability of your Word program to sort of spell check is going to be based on, you know, the language you speak, the language the program is working in. Are you using slang terms, complex medical terms? You know, what's your spell check set for? If there's different levels that it can check for, is it looking for the most common mistakes or all mistakes? And then, of course, the type of mistake. A word that's correctly spelled, just the wrong word, may not be picked up. And so the type of misspelling and how severe that spelling is and how much it changes the word or the meaning of your sentence will affect the outcome of the story. And so that could result in no story being told at all, could result in the story being cut short, could leave out a certain part of the story, it could add to the story, or it could tell a story in the wrong order. So it's really going to depend on those errors in terms of what the outcome will be in our bodies. So again, going back to that term variation, that's why people prefer that, because a change or misspelling is not necessarily considered a mutation or have that negative feeling that we think about when we hear that word. It might just change our eye color or may make somebody's hair straight versus curly. But on the other hand, it actually could actually cause a health condition at the same time, or the inability to walk, or a change in the way a limb looks or a heart functions. But they still just mean an error. And so why do these errors in our DNA and our genes happen? And again, thinking back to typing, if you're typing out a word over and over again, sometimes I've typed, you know, even the word the number of times I look at it, eventually starts to look like it's not spelled T-H-E, even though I know that it is. But if you type that over and over again, you're likely to make an error. The longer the word is, you're going to be more likely to make errors in typing that word over and over. And our cells are constantly dividing and multiplying, and those errors are likely to happen. But our bodies have those built-in housekeeping genes that are supposed to run a spell check and supposed to make sure they correct those errors before they get out of hand. The environment can also create those to happen. So it's not the replication in our cells, but something in the environment that changes the DNA and makes that error happen, which again should be picked up by the spell check. I apologize for my green circles here. The picture below it is what a cell dividing really looks like. But for my purposes, you initially start out with a cell that then duplicates and divides to create two new cells. This is how we grow as we're fetuses and as we continue to age. Those two cells will then duplicate and divide again. So now two cells become four. One of those, however, as I showed in orange, might get a misspelling in it that doesn't get corrected. So that when those four cells duplicate and divide, now you have one orange cell turn into two and the other three green cells turn into six. So now you actually start to have a bunch of cells that are going to have this mutation as it continues to grow and divide. So now you have two different types of cells in one organ, like a kidney, for instance. Again, this duplication is going to continue. And now you may get where the yellow one is, another mutation that pops up that again goes unchecked. And you're going to get the ones in lighter green that will die off. Sometimes those will be ones with the mutation. Sometimes they won't. So this is how the process of, you know, repeating over and over again, this duplication and division of our cells is bound to have some errors in it. And we just hope that the body works appropriately to catch those. So let's take a step back for a second and talk about cancer. And Dr. Mann earlier today sort of walked through this, and he did a great job. So hopefully I can do the same. But a tumor itself is just an uncontrollable growth of cells. Again, cells grow and divide normally as they get older or damaged. They're sort of removed. But there can be six sort of cardinal signs that create a tumor. And that could be that cell ignores the signal that's supposed to stop growing, or it starts to grow even when there's not a signal there. It doesn't get eliminated the way it should. Starts to pull in blood vessels and other energy sources to feed its growth in an unusual way, or it starts to grow and spread to other cells or invade. And as Dr. Mann mentioned, you can have a benign tumor and you can have a malignant tumor. Tumor is just that abnormal growth of cells, but it becomes malignant or becomes a cancer when it starts to invade. And so it starts to sort of expand beyond where it should and invade the surrounding tissue. So what about in our genes, what causes cancer? Where is that link? So now we've covered both, we're gonna link them together. Typically we think of there being three main drivers in cancer. And so these drivers are genes that control how our cells are growing and dividing. So again, there's those genes in there that do that. So one of them is called a proto-oncogene. And this is a gene, you think of it as a gas pedal. It usually stimulates division, which should be happening in your cells, and promotes their survival. So this is something that could be normally happening, but a proto-oncogene, if there's a mutation in it, it's gonna go overboard. It's gonna go crazy. And this is gonna cause, it's gonna promote that oncogene or promote cancer to happen. You could have what we call DNA repair genes. This is that built-in spell check that's in our housekeeping genes. And so if there's a mutation in that, it may not be able to pick up errors as much as it should. And then you also have tumor suppressor genes. These operate more like a brake. So they're normally in the body to keep the growth under control. And if there's a mutation in a tumor suppressor gene, they can't keep that under control. It can't suppress the tumor and the tumors then continue to grow. Tumor suppressor genes are the most common for kidney cancer, with proto-oncogenes being pretty rare and mismatched sort of repair genes around 10% or less. And so all of these things relate back to that growth of the cell or the overgrowth of the cell and not being eliminated or corrected as it should. So why are genetics important? So again, we don't just care what necessarily caused it. We want to be able to sort of figure out, can we find it earlier? If we know what the gene is, can we look for that change and be able to know that cancer could be there? They do this a lot with breast cancer. When we think about improved monitoring options, if we were to find it earlier, can we put the right ultrasound to the right type of cancer that's going to help it more? Is it a CT scan or not? Could it improve your treatment? Could it match you with the right clinical trial? So can it change your care? These are very actionable things, some of which are present for kidney cancer, some that aren't. It might also have a little less action, but give you a prediction of developing cancer. So if you think about something like a BRCA1 gene that we think of causing breast cancer, just because you get a mutation in that gene doesn't mean you're going to develop breast cancer. It does increase your risk from 12% to about 80%, but it's still not a guarantee. The other is something diagnostic. We've talked earlier today about the different types of kidney cancer, and they look different under the microscope, but some of them share similar features, or it's hard to exactly parse out the differences. And so a gene test may be able to help distinguish one type of cancer from another if it's unclear under the microscope. And then you have something that we call prognostic. This is sort of saying we're not changing your care necessarily, we're not being able to predict what type of cancer you may have, but we're going to be able to maybe say, what's the severity going to be? What's the likelihood this could recur? And this is something that's a little less actionable. We don't know necessarily how to stop it from recurring, but you may be able to get information about that likelihood. Currently, it's not recommended to do genetic testing unless there's something that's going to change the patient's care. And this is where there are limitations. Running genetic testing just for the sake of running genetic testing can actually bring about more questions than it does answers, if you remember all that complexity that we talked about. But there are some really rare, really real instances where it can help patients and change not only their state of mind, but as well as thinking about that care or that prediction. this is just something we keep in mind when we decide whether or not to offer genetic testing. When we think about those mutations, whether it's in these driver genes, there's different ways it can happen. And Dr. Mon talked about this, something called germline, which is a really weird term, but the germ cells are the egg and sperm. And so we think of it as it's in every cell of the body, as you could pass it on. So we call it inherited, or we call it familial. And this is usually something that goes from parent to child. And again, really means that it's in all cells of the body, whether you take skin, blood, or a piece of the organ. The other types of mutations can happen sporadically, meaning sometime after the egg and sperm have come together, a mutation happens that is then not fixed. So this is also called somatic or acquired. So these happen again, usually after conception, and it's only present in certain cells. So we go back to the inheritance. So thinking of the ones that can run in families, one of the most common ways we describe it is dominant. And so if you look here in a parent, the orange, you have the two copies of the gene, the orange one has that change in it. That person is only going to pass on one of their gene copies to their children. So the child's going to get the other one from the other parent. And so it's about a 50% chance they pass on the one with the alteration in it. And therefore the children would then have that alteration in all of their cells and therefore have risks of cancer. The other side is recessive, which is a lot rarer for cancer. And that's where each parent has one altered gene, but it actually isn't severe enough to cause the condition. You would have to have two non-working copies in order to present with the condition. So again, this is rare, but the reason I bring it up is because sometimes it operates like both of them. So you have the one mutation that's passed on from the parent, but until the other gene is also affected, maybe by the environment, maybe by a mutation that happens sporadically later on, they're not going to develop the cancer. And this is sort of with the way I mentioned with breast cancer. If you get the BRCA1 gene, you may not get cancer because we need that sort of second hit in order to kick it in. And we don't fully understand what some of these second hits are or how likely they are to occur, but it was something that we discovered in the 1970s is very common in cancer. So even when a gene is inherited, there still might be something else that's needed in order to cause the cancer to occur. And most tumor suppressor genes operate in this fashion. So they're passed on in a dominant fashion if the parent had one, but they still need that second hit. So now that we've sort of talked a little bit about genes and cancer and how genes relate to cancer, I want to talk a little bit about testing. This could be a talk all on its own. So I tried to make this as simple as possible, but I've gotten a lot of questions from patients about, you know, hey, how do I interpret this? What's the best way to look at these results? Are these results meaningful? So I just want to give a little bit of an overview of the two different types of testing that you can have, whether or not we're concerned about something that's inherited or something that's more sporadic. So if we look here for the inherited type of testing, it's a testing that's looking for variants or mutations in a gene that can cause and predispose someone to a specific syndrome or cancer. You're usually taking blood. It's the easiest type of sample to get, but because it's in every cell of your body, you should be able to look for that anywhere. And these tend to be what we call syndromic cancers, cancers that maybe it's not just one cancer you're at risk for, but multiple types of cancer. There may be other health problems that are related to these. You might see this in your family history. Not always, though. As I mentioned, just because you have the mutation doesn't mean you always will get cancer for some of these. And the rarer types of cancer also tend to be part of these syndromes. The main reason people undergo testing for inherited cancers is usually to verify the diagnosis and give them that risk of prediction. What's the other risk for family members? What's your risk of developing other cancers? There's over 50 cancer syndromes. Some will even say close to 100 different cancer syndromes. Anywhere from 1 to 100 genes can be tested for. It used to be for something like breast cancer, you tested for BRCA1 and BRCA2. And now some of these panels are up to, you know, 100 genes long because we know there's so many more genes that are involved. Or they're trying to look at a bunch of different organs at one time. We know that people with thyroid cancer can have some breast cancer mutations sometimes. And so they'll just put them all together. And there's thousands of mutations that they can look for as well. The main results for an inherited genetic test come out as pathogenic or likely pathogenic, which is just a fancy word for disease causing. And this happens in less than 10% of people with these types of tests. They can come back benign, so you can find a change that they know is not going to cause disease. They don't normally report on that, but if they find that, it's called a benign result, or just be negative. They didn't find anything. And that happens to most people when they have these tests. It's all, well, greater than 70% of people sort of fall into this category. And the biggest problem with this is it doesn't make your risk zero. It just means you don't have the inherited form. Again, everybody has around a 12%. Women have a 12% risk of breast cancer. A negative BRCA1 test doesn't make that risk zero. It's still there. And then there's something called a variant of unknown significance, or a VUS. And these are things that we don't have a lot of evidence on. They might not have been seen a lot. It might have been seen in healthy and people with the condition. So we don't really know what to do with it. And this happens about 20% of the time. And if you get a VUS that comes back, it might change. We might find out more. And 3 years from now, we might know what to call it and it'll be reclassified. But this can cause a lot of confusions for both doctors and patients. When we suspect an inherited cancer syndrome, so again, for those inherited or familial syndromes, usually the patient has a family history of more than one cancer type. Not everybody has the same presentation. There may be other medical features. Some of these go along with people having larger limbs on one side of the body than the other. Some can go along with, you know, hearing issues or sight issues. They happen normally at a younger age. They tend to have, if you have, you know, two breasts, two kidneys, they tend to happen bilaterally. So you'll see tumors on both sides. Also tend to be multifocal, again, having more than one tumor, sometimes thousands of tumors in one organ. Anybody up to your third degree relatives, which is your cousin or your grandparents, can affect your risk. So it's important to have those discussions, especially if you get a diagnosis of cancer, of seeing if those family members might have been affected, even though you think, oh, I should only ask my mom, or I only need to ask my sister. You don't. You want to go back farther. You can be, have more than one gene that causes the same syndrome, as you'll see soon. And one gene doesn't just cause one type of cancer. So again, using an example everybody's familiar with in the news, thanks to Angelina Jolie, if you have a mutation in your BRCA1 gene, it can cause breast, pancreatic, prostate, or ovarian cancer, and it can be found in both inherited and somatic cancer types. So if genetics wasn't confusing enough, inherited cancers sort of add to that. And these are the different types of testing. So going back to our word example, you could look for one misspelling in one word. And this is usually when you know what mutation is running in the family. You can look for the most common mutations in one word. There's panels that do this. This tends to be more in certain ethnicities where very specific mutations make up the majority of mutations. You can also look for many different mutations across many different genes. This is becoming more rare. More are now doing, let's look for all the misspellings in any particular word, or let's look for all the misspellings across many different words. Because now that we know more about the human genome, we have that information to be able to look at. So these are becoming more and more common, but it has to be balanced with adding more things can add more confusion, and not running enough can cause more cost because more tests will need to be run if things come back negative. And so that was sort of the inherited side. From the sporadic or the somatic side, you're testing again for mutations, but you're really looking for mutations that have an actionable result for at least one type of cancer. So again, something that's going to change treatment, something that's going to maybe link to an approved drug that is more helpful when someone has that mutation, or for a clinical trial that can really give you some, maybe some more research that's being done on a particular mutation or a particular cancer type. The sample, though, is not usually blood. It's usually the tissue that the tumor is in, or the tumor itself. So if it's kidney cancer, you're taking a piece of, you would during a biopsy or a piece when they've removed the kidney. But they are now looking into some things where they can draw it from blood and find things floating in the bloodstream. or they can find it in urine. So there are ways that they are now starting to look for these, but the tissue is still the main way to look. These are mainly done for advanced cancers, so cancers that have spread or have recurred and come back, versus early stage cancers. Again, if we're linking to drug treatments, these are the people more likely to go on drug treatment. And we've already mentioned that we're looking for those treatment and prognosis is increasing. Again, the ability to say what's the likelihood it might recur, but it's still in its early stages. Just like with inherited cancer testing, there can be multiple genes, multiple cancers, multiple therapies they're looking at. They're not just looking at mutations. They may look at, again, the whole story. So they're looking at the whole sort of gene or the protein, not just particular mutations. The results come out a little differently. Again, they're not looking for a cause. So you tend to see words like, this is a relevant mutation. This is an actionable mutation. They'll let you know if it's linked to a approved FDA therapy, whether it's for your organ. So they'll say, well, there is an approved therapy in kidney cancer, or there's an approved therapy in lung cancer. And they'll list those. Even if you have kidney cancer, they still may let you know that this mutation is being treated in lung cancer with a certain medication, because there may be some clinical trials as well that could help with that. And there's a lot of other terms for this. So liquid biopsy, biomarker testing, tumor testing or tumor subtyping, circulating tumor testing, and companion diagnostics. That's probably the one that makes the most sense, because they're trying to find a treatment with the diagnosis of the mutation. So this, they're companions to each other. And so if you look at this, I stole this graphic from Dr. Maria Carlo, but normally when it comes to medicine, we used to just say, hey, if somebody has high blood pressure, this is a medicine for high blood pressure. But then we wondered why some people did well on it, some people didn't, and then some people had bad side effects. And we had to take them off. It was something severe. And we realized it's all the other genes and all the other stories in their bodies that are interacting with the genes that you have. And therefore, if we can decide what gene has a mutation in it that makes a medication more or less effective, we can make a specific medication recommendation based on that. And so that every patient can benefit from a therapy that's specific to them. One that's recently been approved in the kidney cancer space is FDA has said that there's a new medication, belzutifan, which is used for people that have the von Hippel-Lindau mutation. There's also something called PD-L1 positive. This isn't a gene change. This is just something in the immune system that if they test for it and it's present, can make you more responsive to immunotherapies. And so they consider this a biomarker, but it's not a gene mutation. I do caution, though, that this is still early. There's not a lot of great guidelines in the genetics community or otherwise for what tests to run. On the inherited side, there's a lot more going on that we sort of have had over the years to recommend testing or not, but that's not necessarily the case here. So standard of care is definitely still effective. Your doctor still can make those great decisions even without genetic testing, but it is something that you should consider. So again, this biomarker or the sporadic testing or somatic testing is complex. Not every tumor or cancer is going to have a detectable biomarker. This could be due to the sample that's received, could be due to, when we think about that orange and green and yellow picture I showed earlier, it might be a very low percentage that have the orange mutation. Think of it as a bag of marbles that have different color marbles in it. Every time you put your hand in, you may get a different selection of marbles, and that green one or orange one may or may not be there. Different cells in the tumor can have different biomarkers or different mutations. Again, the orange and the yellow could develop differently. A lot of malignant tumors are going to have multiple mutations in them. And so if we are able to look, you're likely find more than one. In an inherited cancer, you usually find one in the blood, versus here, you're going to find multiple ones in the tumor. Some biomarkers can also be seen in healthy individuals. It doesn't always mean cancer. Errors happen, they correct themselves, they get eliminated. This test may pick up one, or it can change over time. Again, the green makes then orange mutation, and then later on a yellow mutation, and the orange ones may die. Therapy may affect which cells die off or which ones are treated. So I have this child here crying, because this is sometimes how people feel with this, is what do I do? Where are those guidelines? How do I know how to handle this? And so it's not to say genetic testing should be avoided, but you should definitely make sure to have discussions with somebody who is familiar with genetics when they're going to offer the testing, so that all these things can be thought out with results. So if we think about, we talked about genes, we talked about cancer, we talked about genes and cancer and testing, how does this play in for kidney cancer? And so if we think about one of these gray blocks representing 1,000 people with kidney cancer, in 2022, there's going to be approximately 79,000 new people diagnosed with kidney cancer. Out of those patients, about 5 to 16% are going to be due to inherited germline familial syndromes. And the reason there's a range is because it depends. Overall, it's about 5 to 8%. But if you look at the later stage patients and some of the rarer cancer types, you actually have a little bit of a higher chance that it's going to be an inherited gene. So what about the rest? What about all these other cases? And these are a combination of those somatic or sporadic mutations, environmental modifications, begin sometimes being subjected to certain chemicals will increase the risk that those cells will get errors in it and cause a tumor. And then there's still some things, unfortunately, we just don't know. And that's true with any cancer. This is not a chart you need to spend tons of time on, but these are a collection of the inherited cancer syndromes, what genes tend to be involved with that. And you can see some of these have multiple genes, so they would be done sort of together if you were looking for this. Some have certain specific types of kidney tumors that would be selected. So if you don't have a papillary type of kidney cancer, not going to suggest running HPRC. The chance of getting kidney cancer also varies. So just because you have the mutation, not only is it only one of the types of cancer that may pop up, but some of these, it's a really high chance of kidney cancer. Others are a lower chance of kidney cancer compared to some of the other cancers that may pop up with those syndromes. And so that's why it's important to know that are there other cancers in other family members? Who were those family members? So that the right type of testing can be run. So if we do suspect a particular type of test or a particular type of condition, that test can be recommended off of that. But one of the things with kidney cancer is that some of the common drivers that we talked about aren't common in kidney cancer. So proto-oncogenes, the only one really here is MET. Everything else is pretty much sort of acts as a tumor suppressor or a repair gene. And even these genes aren't some of the ones you see in other cancers. There's other genes that are very common across multiple cancer types that we just don't see in kidney cancer. So we don't have as much information about them as we would for other cancer types. The other thing I really want to stress, and this is something that is one of my, something near and dear to me because it's a clinic I worked in grad school. We talked about the different drivers, but there aren't just cancer genes that can increase somebody's chance of cancer. Sickle cell disease is a recessive inherited condition where the red blood cells, instead of being circular, are shaped like little sickles, like something you'd cut down wheat with in a field. And this is, comes about again, one mutation would come from one parent, one would come from the other, who are called carriers, and their condition would be sickle cell trait. They don't have full-blown disease. A lot of time they're told there's no risks at all and they're going to be relatively healthy, which for the majority of those patients is true. The chance that there's going to be a carrier is dependent on your ethnicity. So it's a lot more common for certain things related to malaria in African Americans or Hispanic Americans, but it's not zero in the Caucasian population either. If you have sickle cell trait, again, majority of those patients aren't going to have any symptoms. They're not going to have the pain and low blood counts that people with sickle cell disease have. However, one in every 20,000 people with sickle cell trait will get a severe type of kidney cancer called renal medullary cancer. And this is often not mentioned. And so again, the chance is rare, but this is why it's very important to know whether or not you have sickle cell trait. If you start having back pain, especially in the flank area, if you have blood in your urine, it's definitely something to bring up with your doctor to make sure that those just aren't other issues to deal with the sickle trait, but all could be an issue with the renal medullary. And the earlier you can catch renal medullary, the better, but it is still a very aggressive and severe cancer. So this was brought up just to let you know, it's not just cancer genes. This one's a gene of the blood. You think, well, what does that have to do with kidney cancer? But things that deal with the blood, with getting energy to cells, oxygen in cells, all those types of things can sometimes increase the risk for cancer, even though it's not a specific tumor gene, so to speak. So we really caution in any area that people are aware of their sickle cell trait status, especially if they start to have symptoms of kidney cancer. So there were recommendations that came out last year as far as if you suspect an inherited condition, how to go about testing. 33 experts got together and they looked to see if they could agree on who should get testing or not, depending on who in the family was affected, what features they had, did they themselves have kidney cancer or not, how old they were. The average age for getting cancer in kidney cancer is about 64 years of age. 10% of people are under the age of 46, but of those people with inherited forms of kidney cancer, 70% of them are under the age of 46. So if you're younger when you're diagnosed, it's a really big indicator, but not the only indicator that you should have genetic testing done. They also talk in these consensus statements about doing more genes than just a single gene in order to have bigger bang for your buck. But basically, they're still up in the air in terms of when to have the testing. There's not a lot of consensus on, you know, how early and do you need a biopsy first or not a biopsy and what do you do? So we're starting to look for better guidelines on testing across many organizations. But I think the bottom line is that it's always recommended to have pre-test counseling with your doctor or a genetic specialist to limit the errors in interpretation and making sure the right tests are run on you and that you're getting the right information. So in conclusion, there's still a lot of holes, especially when it comes to somatic testing. There's no guarantee that if you do a genetic test, you're going to get a clear or actionable result that'll change things for you. It might not always give you the peace of mind that you're looking for either. Insurances may or may not cover the genetic testing or the therapy that it's recommending. There definitely are insurance issues, even though Medicare does cover somatic testing in patients that are stage three or stage four. There's still, you know, going to be controversy on all for sure. And as Dr. Sutka mentioned in the last couple talks, make sure you do seek out information on what may or may not be covered or cost-wise. There are some protections against discrimination with health insurance in terms of increasing your rates if you're positive, but this doesn't apply to everybody, like military personnel, also doesn't apply to life insurance policies. And make sure if there's a direct-to-consumer test, these are very limited when it comes to health information. They're not looking for a wide variety of mutations. They're not very helpful in managing care. So especially when it comes to cancer, I would avoid these direct-to-consumer tests and using them to make decisions. So kidney cancer is a group of conditions that have different features, risks, causes, genetic profiles, and treatments. And although genetic plays a role, it's not the only role. There's a lot of other things that play into this complex puzzle. And not all genetic testing is the same, nor will it change things for everybody. And it's more limited in kidney, but I don't want to give the impression that we're not making strides, and getting tested and being part of trials and registries is only going to increase this knowledge. And every day, something new is being studied and offers a lot of promise in terms of having the genetics give us a clue for better treatment and better prediction. All right. So, question time. Anyone? It's a lot of information today, especially being one of the later ones going. So I'm not offended by it at all. But feel free to, you know, seek out the KCA, get in touch with our patient navigator who can connect you to me if you do have questions on genetic testing. But it is definitely very complex and not as straightforward as you would think. So don't feel that you're missing out on something major if you aren't able to get genetic testing done. But it definitely is something you should always be discussing with your doctor as an option. All right. Actually, we're going to take a little 4-minute break before we start the last session of the day, just to give everybody a little chance. I will correct that. We have one question that did pop up. Any studies being done regarding family histories of cancer that lay people may be related? I had kidney cancer. my father has prostate. Are there any connections there? There definitely can be. There are studies being done all the time, and lots of them. I'm probably going to reach out to you individually. There's a little more information than just knowing the two cancer types that can help sort of give you an idea on what direction to go and give you some good lay materials to read as well that'll sort of help pull some of that information together. So I will definitely reach out to you after the conference and sort of connect and help answer the question further. But we're going to take a break. We'll be back in about 5 minutes.